noble potrillo que justo en la raya afloja al llegar y que al regresar parece decir no olvides hermano, vos sabés, no hay que jugar. Por una cabeza me tejón de un día de aquella coqueta y risueña mujer que al jurar sonriendo el amor que está mintiendo quema en una hoguera todo mi querer. Por una cabeza todas las locuras, tu boca que besa borra la tristeza, calma la amargura. Por una cabeza si ella me olvida, ¿qué importa perderme mil veces la vida? ¿Para qué vivir? Cuánto desengaño por una cabeza. Yo juré mil veces, no vuelvo a insistir. Pero si un mirar me hiere al pasar, tu boca de fuego otra vez quiero besar. Basta de carreras, se acabó la timba, un final reñido yo no vuelvo a ver. Pero si algún bingo llega a ser fija el domingo, yo me juego entero, ¿qué le voy a hacer? Por una cabeza, toda la locura, tu boca que besa, borra la tristeza, calma la amargura. Por una cabeza, mi olvida, ¿qué importa perderme mil veces la vida? ¿Para qué vivir?
Entonces, buenos días a todos, buen día. And welcome, actually, since we have to do that in English today. Since we are doing actually this as a part of the project for the seventh time of the Summer School on Latin American Studies, and I have to say that we are very proud as an institute. Estamos muy orgullosos por tener parte de este gran, hacer parte de este gran convenio y gran proyecto. I just want to say really that it's a great honor that we, in spite of the pretty crazy times, actually several years of COVID and everything that was going on, succeeded to keep up the pace and to continue to have for the seventh year here, which of course is, of course, I hope that Dejan is with us, Professor Dejan Mihajlović, who is really always, I have to mention, somebody to whom we all have a huge debt for starting, actually connecting us with Latin America generally and with Hispanic world in many ways. But actually, the most of the work here has been done by this small but very effective and efficient lady, our friend Yelena, who is with us and who is really pushing, of course, with new and new generations of young Hispanists who are today also with us. And I'm so happy that we are having new young faces who will take this and push it forward. Anyway, as a part of the Seventh School, which was officially initiated last evening in Parobrod Cultural Center, where we had the chance already to listen to our today's guest, Professor Andrés Malamud. He spoke actually yesterday on Argentina and everything that's been going on and so on. So we got so many things to know about this country. And in a way, we already made some introduction, of course, with Carlos Cartel in the Por Una Cabeza, one of the most famous Porteño song, although he is not really Porteño in a way, but we spoke yesterday about the province and Porteños themselves and so on, but it's about time that I start really presenting the whole our project, beside, of course, Association of the Hispanists of Serbia, who initiated this. We, of course, have to greet Professor Bojana Petrović, our collaborator from Novi Sad. I hope that she is also with us. Who is leading a CBAM project at Philosophy Faculty, Centro Ibero-Americano, which will, that's also one of the great news that I have to share with you, within 2 years be the leader actually of the project of the Congress of Latin Americanists that was just finished this year in Foz do Iguaçu in Brazil. And so many good things about Hispanism and Latin American studies in Serbia have been really happening. So as if I could say, we in a way, not to be too unpolite to other participators in this school, this year's school, because there are really some really great names, including our professors and very interesting person that was guest in vivo, Chilean writer of Serbian origin, Andrea Jeftanović. Who was very inspirative here for people and who will be also sharing her thoughts via Zoom during the school. But actually, as we planned, this year's peak, in a way, is really the visit of our today's guest. I could speak quite a lot about Professor Andrés Malamud, who is from Buenos Aires and from Argentina originally, and I will just mention a couple of the stuff in technical terms that he finished UBA, the famous University of Buenos Aires. After that, he moved to Europe to also very famous place, especially for European studies, and this is European Institute or University in Florence, where he's pursued his PhD. He was working in teaching in many universities from Latin America, Brazil, Mexico, of course, Argentina, but also he spent some time in Maryland. He was working with the Max Planck Institute in Germany and so many places. Actually, I mentioned yesterday, I have to repeat, really, when you go to Google Scholar Citation Index, you will see that he has almost 6,000 of them with a very good reason and so on. For 20 years already, he is being settled in Portugal, another very interesting and dear to us country in Europe, where he's been teaching at the political sciences there. And he's basically interested, when I'm speaking about him, he's a political scientist, although you will see that he really covers very broad range of the issues, subjects from culture up to statistics and so on. But of course, he's very focused on politics in Latin America, in Argentina. Yesterday, we had very nice forecast, if I could say, about the coming elections that will be this year, this autumn in Argentina. Very interesting and in a way pretty decisive about what's going on generally. He's what we also ask him today to share with us, dealing a lot with integrations, with the processes of integration, regional integration in Europe and in Latin America. And for that, we ask him to speak today about some kind of comparison on how actually integrations are been going in one and other place. For example, yesterday he shared with us, I didn't know that, for example, at the elections in Argentina, they also vote not only for president, parliament, and so on, but also for their representatives in Mercosur, which is kind of a framework for Latin American integration there and so on. So in that sense, it resembles in a way to the elections for the European Parliament in Europe and so on. And of course, we ask him to put that within the actual terms, which are unfortunately very much colored by the war that is going on in Europe. And in a way, many people saw that as a first of many future changes in the world, that actually you see the things in between China and USA, which will define the future relationship generally. So without further ado, I already spoke too much. I'm more than happy that we can agree to their Professor Andrés Malamud. After that, of course, as you know, we will have the chance to ask him about Argentina, about all those topics and so on, and many other things. And before I start, I'm more than glad that I could also share the fact that today we also have gentlemen from Argentinian embassy and from Portuguese embassy, which are defining identities of in a way two countries that are sharing Andrés thoughts and, in a way, I could say, of the love even and so on. So please, Andrés, floor is you.
Thank you very much for the invitation. I am honored to be here. And you are right, my identifying music is Fado and Tango and Beatles. So all together here.
General.
Yeah, that's me. But the song you played, it was featured in at least two films, very famous ones. Sense of a Woman with Al Pacino and True Lies with Arnold Schwarzenegger. And they are moving the films and the scenes in which this song is played. But today, we are going to speak. Do we have a presentation to share? I'm going to introduce a comparison and the relationship between Latin America and Europe. And I have some pictures to show you. And the idea is first to contend that Europe and Latin America have a lot in common, and that's not necessarily good. What both regions have in common is that they are becoming peripheral to world politics. The world is becoming post-Western, but the US is still a resilient power, a superpower. And the emerging new power is China. So the old world, as we know Europe was called in the past, and the new world, that is the Americas, but for the US, are becoming in second place, which is not necessarily bad. But they have lots of things in common as well. Lots of things that make them separate, that contrast them with each other. And integration is one of them. I mentioned yesterday that Argentina is going to elect deputies to Mercosur Parliament. But these are not really meaningful, because Mercosur does not have a decision-making parliament. It's kind of a witness of things happening. It has declaratory powers. It has no decision-making powers. So integration in Europe is post-Westphalian. Westphalia was the agreement in 1648 by which we know national sovereignty was created. The states decided that their borders should not be crossed by other monarchs, and every state had the right to decide the religion of their subjects. The European Union is a step forward over national sovereignty, over the borders. So most European states, especially Western European states, share borders, no need to flash a passport. They share a currency. They have the Erasmus program. Every single common decision should be translated into the language of each other. So they are kind of a new animal, not a state, but not a super, not an international organization. They are. That's very nice of your system. Latin America is a very Westphalian region, just like Africa, just like North America, just like Asia. Only it is a very peaceful Westphalian region. There are wars taking place in Europe. There are wars taking place in Africa. There are wars taking place in Asia. There are no wars taking place in Latin America. It's a very peaceful region. You may think of Latin America as a very unstable region because governments come and go. But it's geopolitically very stable. The borders are fixed. The countries that exist today in Latin America, there are 20, were there in 1945 when the UN was established. 20 Latin American states then, 20 Latin American states today. At the beginning of the UN, there were 14 European countries. Now there are 50-something. You here know the story very well. Where should I aim to? It has batteries because there is a light here. Can you do that? Yeah, thank you. Well, but as I told you, there are no wars in Latin America, but there are wars everywhere else. And this is today the most important one. This is Russia invading Ukraine, but this is not about this war. This was about Chernobyl, the fusion of the nuclear reactor in 1986. And the important thing here is the direction of the radiation. Nuclear radiation goes west because of the rotation of the Earth and the direction of the winds. And this is what Putin knows, and everybody else knows too. The thing is that a nuclear event is riskier to Europe than to Russia. And a nuclear event could be a nuclear attack, a nuclear accident, provoked or not, and a dirty bomb, conventional explosion that distributes nuclear radiation. And this is what Europeans have in mind when they run to the pharmacies from time to time and they buy yodo, in order to protect their glands from radiation. This doesn't happen in the rest of the world. Africans, Latin Americans, and Asians are not running to the pharmacies. This is a global phenomenon for the Europeans. For the rest of the world, the thing is rising prices of food and energy, but it's not about the possibility of being destroyed. So Europeans can be killed, and the European Union can be dissolved if things run bad. So perceptions are very important, and perceptions are rooted in reality. And the reality is that Europe is risking its very existence. The rest of the world is not. And the thing is that the rest of the world is unaware of how afraid Europeans are. And Europeans are unaware of how distant the rest of the world is. And this is key to understand each other. Could you go forward, please?
Go forward.
Now, I am sorry that labels are in Spanish, but we might practice, yeah. Food. Many countries in the world are dependent on food imports. Much of this food comes from Europe, from Russia and Ukraine, which especially, but not only. And this is very influential in African politics, and this is key. Poor countries rebel when food is lacking. Middle-income countries rebel when transport prices go up. Revolutions in Africa happen because of food prices, just like the French Revolution. Revolutions or revolts in Latin America happens when gas or metro or bus prices go up. Every single revolt in Latin America since Caracas in 1989 happens because of transport prices. In Africa, it's a very different story. So this is another thing we have to take into account. Europe is different from Africa and Latin America. And Latin America and Africa are different from each other as well. Food in Africa, energy in Latin America. This is what keeps or breaks political instability in this continent. And here you can see the African dependence on food coming from Ukraine and Russia. Again, this is very important because we will see nothing like this in Latin America. As we can see, well, this is the countries that depend the most at the bottom of the line. Egypt, among them, one of the most populated European African countries and one of the most powerful African powers, precisely. So very important powers. Very important powers in Africa depend on what is happening in Europe. fewer countries depend in Latin America on what is happening in Europe. This is how much countries in Latin America depend on imports from Ukraine. As you can see, the countries that depend the most are small. And the large countries in Latin America depend very little. So the impact is very indirect in Latin America, while it is very direct in Africa. So Europeans are afraid of destruction, Africans are afraid of famine, and Latin Americans are afraid of prices. For now, because many countries in Latin America are food exporters and energy exporters. So an indirect consequence in the long run for Latin America could be, think of this, beneficial. Some countries in Latin America could extract a benefit out of this crisis, out of destruction, which is happening elsewhere. And what I am saying is that some countries, because again, it depends on which countries produce energy and food and which countries import energy and food. They are not alike. We know that in South America, most countries are natural resource exporters. Brazil exports soybeans and iron ore. Argentina exports soybeans, meat. Uruguay exports meat. Paraguay, soybeans. Chile, copper. Now Chile, Bolivia, and Argentina, lithium. They are going to benefit from high prices in world markets. Africa is not. But there are some countries that are going to suffer, Central American countries mostly, and Mexico, it depends on how it mixes up its basket of exports and imports. Mexico is a car exporter, not an oil exporter right now, differently from the past, in which oil was the main export from Mexico and Venezuela alike. And this is the end result so far. This is how countries behave in the world as a response to the war. This is the condemnation at the UN General Assembly. Countries vote every year. There have been two votes already against the invasion. Most countries oppose Russian invasion to Ukraine based on principles such as national sovereignty and territorial integrity. And you can see the numbers there, 140 plus countries condemned the invasion. There are some countries that abstained and just five that were against this resolution. Some countries did not vote, for example, Venezuela, because they did not pay their fees to the United Nations. So it's just an economic reason not to be a participant state. But there are two things here. First one is that those countries that abstained have the same population as those countries that condemned. So when we think in the West and in Latin America, in Europe and in Latin America, that most of the world is against the invasion, yes, most countries, but not most peoples, because China and India abstained, and they together make up 40%, more or less, of the world population. So this is important. The world is splitting into those that think that this is happening because of Russia, and it should be condemned, and those that prefer not to say anything about this. And in the next, you are going to see something that maybe you may relate to this from Serbia. Sanctions. Condemnation is massive. Sanctions are not. Only 1/4 of total countries in the world are applying, let's say, not unilateral, but kind of multilateral, but not institutional sanctions against Russia. Most of Europe, North America, and their allies in the Pacific. As for Latin America, known. Africa, known. Asia, very few. So the world is divided. The invasion of Ukraine did not make us all equal. We do not perceive the events in the same way because of different geographical positions and different developmental positions. Those poor suffer hunger, those middle class suffer prices, those who are close suffer fear of destruction. And so the world is split, and the world is drifting towards the Indo-Pacific. How you define this region depends on what geopolitical interests you have. Indo-Pacific, Eastern Pacific, Southern Eastern Pacific, Asia Pacific. The thing is that half of the world population live in the circle that is illuminated in this map. We don't realize this. We can have a look around this room and we are going to see Western people. Western people are on the minority of the world population. This has been so for a long time, but now it has political consequences. People who are not Western are stronger than ever before. And the world is becoming post-Western, partly because of demography. So when we look at Europe and Latin America, we see regions that are becoming peripheral. This is not new for Latin America. It has always been a peripheral region. But this is new for Europe, who used to be in the center of world affairs. Both world wars were initiated in Europe. Now there is a big war in Europe, a big war for Europe. As I mentioned before, it is not that big for the rest of the world. The world is thinking of what may happen in Taiwan, not in Ukraine. What we matter, because what we mind because we are here, closer to Ukraine, doesn't matter that much the rest of the world. And the reason is first democracy and then economy. This is how Asia has surpassed the West. You can see here that those countries that are located in the Far East are today larger economically than the key G7. So Japan is included in the red line. And Japan, together with the US, with Canada, and the big countries of Europe, have a smaller economy than the Asian powers. This is the world we are walking towards. In this world, Europe and Latin America are thinner, are smaller, not bigger. Like, again, I am trying to argue later that this is not necessarily bad. This is another way of looking at this, but the most important thing about this graphic is that the US is not receding. When I speak of a post-Western world, I don't take America out of the picture. America is still the hyperpower in the world. It's still receding. It's receding, but it's becoming post-Western as well. It has already had a black president, and it's becoming more Asian. If you go to California, you are going to find Asia in California, not in New York that much, but it's becoming a post-Western country as well. The white minority, the WASP, are going to become a minority if they are not already a minority, white Anglo-Saxon Protestant people in America. So the world is changing, and America is changing together with the world. And this is what is key, in my view, to understand what is happening to Latin America. We mentioned yesterday, in the talk about Argentina, that most regions are homogeneous because they are defined by geography. Africa, Middle East, Eastern Asia, North America, Europe. Latin America is the only hybrid region in the world. We define Latin America with two words. Latin, which is culture, and America, which is geography. But it's a very long extended region with a vertical axis that makes most of it different from the rest. In very few words, if you are Mexico, you are doomed to your relations with the United States. That's your main, most important border. It's like having a border with Russia. It defines you. Argentina, Chile, Uruguay, Brazil, they don't have a border with the US. They are 5,000 kilometers away or 10,000 kilometers away from the US. So the US don't define their identity, and they don't define their foreign policy or the economic policy. Again, in short, the top trading partner of Mexico is the US. The top trading partner of Brazil is China. And this is, bless you, the only region in which China is splitting it apart. If you look at trading partners, Asia is a Chinese sphere of influence. Africa is a Chinese sphere of influence. Oceania is a Chinese sphere of influence. Europe is a German sphere of influence. What we see here is which is the top trading partner for each country in the world. If they are in red, it is China. In orange, it is Germany. In blue, it is the United States. So think of this. The US and Germany are big regional powers. The only global power is China. And this emergence of China split only Latin America. From Venezuela and Colombia northwards, they depend more on the States. Southwards, they depend more on China and Asia. So there are two Latin Americas. And what they do in foreign policy depends on who they depend on. And this is zoom in all South America. You know that for many people who are not Latin Americans, they collapse South America and Latin America. They are not the same. South America is kind of half of Latin America, and it includes Guyana and Suriname, two independent countries, plus French Guiana, which is part of the European Union. So this is kind of paradoxical. You know, there are outermost regions in Europe, in Portugal, Azores and Madeira, in Spain, Canarias, and then the French, they had a lot. There is only one which is continental, and that's French Guiana. That means that you can walk literally from Brazil to the European Union. And you can see this in the next figure I will show you, but this is important in this sense. In South America, there is a split as well. The northern countries depend on the US, the rest on China, even though there are some countries that depend on China via Brazil. Argentina, Bolivia, and Paraguay have Brazil as top trading partner. But when China grows, Brazil grows, and all these countries benefit. When China does not grow, Brazil does not grow, and all these countries suffer. So it is China at last. This is just for us to have a dimension of what we are talking about, because as you can see in the next one, Latin America is very big. It's very big. Or rather, Europe is very small, because Latin America is just like Asia or Africa. Most regions, most continents in the world are large. Europe is not. And this is why some people speak of the Eurasian continent. Europe being a small peninsula of the Eurasian landmass. And the ones who are speaking about this nowadays are the Chinese. If you look at the documents that Chinese are issuing from time to time, they sometimes speak of Asia and Europe, but sometimes they speak of Eurasia. Eurasia being their continent. So they belong to the same continent as Europe. Think of this and worry. And now I'm getting a little bit into integration. This is a sensitive topic to be dealt with in Europe, but especially in Germany. There are five reasons by which the European Union decided to share sovereignty. The European countries decided to share sovereignty with their neighbors. This is not normal. This is not natural. Since Westphalia, countries decide to keep sovereignty for themselves, not to share it. There was an exception, and the exception was due to this. The five factors that you can find in Europe and nowhere else are, first, German blame, guilt. The Germans blamed themselves because of what they did, the Holocaust. So guilt is very important. The French did not feel guilty, or the Austrian, or the Italians. Most other countries who were allies to the Germans, they cleaned up their past as a resistance to the Germans. The only other country that did sound like the Germans is Japan. But so the Germans felt guilty, and they had the resources to pay for their guilt. And so first, Germany blamed itself. Second, it had resources. Coal and steel to start with, but many others as well. And then it was France who had the political capacity to play, blame, and resources and make Germany pay to get back into the concept of nations. Think of the founders of the European Union, as we call it today, European Coal and Steel Community, European Economic Communities. They were French who spoke German as well. Jean Monnet, Robert Schuman. So they were French statesmen that thought of Germany as a problem and the solution. There are no many other countries in the world that are so guilty as Germany, so rich as Germany, or so skillful as France. And then there was the Soviet threat. So Western European countries should get together in order to defend from the Russian bear. And then the Marshall Plan. You don't find in the world a bunch of nations that are so threatened by a common enemy and so helped by a common friend. Give me a Marshall Plan and a Russian threat in Latin America, and I will give you a united Latin America. But in Brazil, Fernando Henrique Cardoso used to say that he talked to Helmut Kohl about integration, and Kohl recommended him generosity. Generosity is the key to integration. And Fernando Henrique Cardoso would say, yeah, you are generous because you are rich. We are not. And this is right. Brazil is the largest economy in Latin America, but not the richest. GDP per capita, Uruguay, Argentina, Chile are richer than Brazil. So what's the reason why Brazil should give money to help richer neighbors? And then, and this is important as well, integration is a mobile target. You are not going to see it as an end product. It's a process. At the beginning of integration, look at this. There were two things that today are so unreal. First, Germany was not united. Today, it is obvious that Germany is the most powerful country in Europe. Well, not counting Russia as a European, totally European power. Germany is a country. It was two countries by then. Two countries. And it was one with not full sovereignty, the one that was behind that. In fact, it was France thinking of integration and Germany coming behind. First thing, Germany was not one, but two, and only part of it entered the integration process. And second, Africa was part of the European process of integration because it was France. So what we can see here is that part of Germany came into the process later and part of France went out of the process later. We usually think of Brexit as a rupture process. It was not the first one. It was first part of France, then Greenland, special case. Greenland left without Denmark leaving. And so when we think of integration as a successful process, yes, it is today. In the beginning, it was not granted that it would have success. So when we think of integration somewhere else out of Europe, we should have this in mind. Nobody imagined at this moment that Portugal would be a full member of the European Union. Portugal is as into the process of integration as anyone else. It shares everything as much as Germany. And it presided over the European Commission for 10 years. But it shares everything, Erasmus, Schengen, Euro, current, everything. It is into the Leopard coalition, just like Germany and Sweden, the only ones with A5 and A6. It is into the F-16 coalition, 11 countries. It is in the hard core nucleus of the integration. By then, it was so peripheral, it was not even pictured in the map. Now, well, this is an old map because Croatia is out and Britain is in. So you think it's moving. Integration is a process, not a product. We don't know the end state of integration. And this map you can see, top right, French Guiana, which in the next slide you are going to see even better. You have something like, no, you don't. But in most of Western Europe, they have this currency, these bills in their pockets. Yeah. And if you look closely, close to the O of Euro, bottom right of Europe, that's French Guiana. And if you look closely, you are going to see Brazil. So Brazil is depicted in the Euro bill. This is the relativity of geography. Integration is about politics. Yes, it's about it's about geographical contiguity. More or less, there are exceptions. And the most important thing here is not that you can see Brazil, but that you can see Cyprus. Because originally Cyprus was out. It came into the process of integration in 2005. The Euro bill came into circulation in 2001. And so in the first picture of the Euro, there was no place for Cyprus. They had to redraw the Euro bill. Nobody knew. It was 4 years. Not 40 years, not 400 years. In 4 years, nobody could see that the European Union was going to enlarge and become a different animal. Why am I saying this so loudly? Because Europe is changing all the time. Europeans don't see this. They think they are stable and prosperous and democratic, and most of them are. But it's changing. It's a very unstable continent. 15 countries out of the Soviet Union, 17 out of Yugoslavia. And for us, external observers, Yugoslavia was a country made up of 6 republics, and it produced 7, so it split more than the sum of its parts, Czechoslovakia. And it's going to continue splitting. Maybe not now, But what about Scotland? How long can they stay? They want to get back into the European Union. What about Spain? We don't know. Portugal is going to remain Portugal. But Spain, who can tell? Nothing like this is going to happen in Latin America. It's the most geopolitically stable region in the world. No borders are going to change, no wars are going to be waged. But usually people think of Latin America as an unstable region. And again, instability can be political at the domestic level. And many times it does not regard democracy. Democracy stays, governments go. But in order for us to have a notion of comparison, this is a functional map of European integration. You can see that most countries want to belong to the inner circle, where they share everything, human rights, currency, borders. And then the countries that are in the outer circles, they would like to get into the inner circles. There are exceptions. Denmark, with its opt-outs. Sweden, in some regards. Britain, who left. But most countries want to go as deep as they can. So it's concentric integration. The idea is that it is progressive. It goes forward. And during a long time, those who study regional integration thought of it as either a bicycle or a tricycle. And you know the difference. In a tricycle, you can stay hold, you can be still, and then restart. You are not going to fall down. In a bicycle, you have to keep pedaling on, otherwise you fall down. What is integration like? A tricycle that you can stay for a while in the place where you are, or a bicycle in which you have to go forward, otherwise you go down? Well, it is a bicycle. The European Union is in an unstable equilibrium. Either it unifies fiscality and banks, or it disintegrates the currency, and they know it. So either they advance on fiscal matters and banking matters, or they go back down with the euro in the future. Now we cross the ocean, South America in this case. And what I want to show you here is that most people in South America live differently from Europe. In what sense? In Europe, most people live in the center, and they are joined by rivers. Danube, for example, brings you together with many other European countries. You can sail Danube, and you can go from capital to capital. In South America, not Latin, not in Central America, in South America, it's the other way around. Geography divides people. It doesn't bring people together. It's not about common rivers. It's about forests and deserts, mountains, that bring people apart, tear people apart. Most people in Brazil, 80%, live 200 kilometers from the sea. It means they live 200 kilometers from their neighbors. If you live in northeast Brazil and you take a plane to go to Africa, it takes you 3 hours. If you want to go to the other side of Brazil, to Acre, it takes you 4 hours. So many Brazilians live closer to Africa than to other Brazilians. The dimension of this continent is giant. It's huge. And it was easy to integrate Europe. It wasn't easy. It took you a lot of wars. But when they decided in Europe to integrate, they were small and they were together, united by geography. In South America, it is a very large continent and people is divided by geography. So when we speak of integration as successful in Western Europe and failed in Latin America, it's not because in Latin America they are inept or corrupt, or at least not just because of this. The thing is that there is no reason to integrate this large desert in the middle. People live on the shores, and they think of, if they live on the Atlantic shore, they think of Europe. And most of people in Argentina, Uruguay, and southern Brazil came from Europe. If you live on the other side, on the Pacific, you think of Asia. Think of Fujimori. In Peru, they had a Japanese president. This happens in the Pacific. Different thing happens in the Atlantic. So the oceans split up this continent. The Atlantic Ocean kept Europe together. Europe was pressed between the Atlantic and Russia. Latin America is torn by the two oceans. And its economic geography is very different as well. If you go to northern Latin America, you manufacture things. Even if it is maquilas, you just put things together. You don't incorporate technology, you don't raise productivity, but you have factories and people working in factories and you sell to the US. If you live in South America, you work in the fields and you sell to China. And if you live in central, in the Caribbean especially, you have nice beaches and banks and safe havens, fiscal havens. And so you receive money and tourists. And then you may have sugar or some things. But it's a very different the living you make in one region of Latin America from other regions of Latin America. And the thing is the geography of natural resources and the partners you get with those resources. And then we usually don't think of the demographic stock of Latin America. If you look at a European summit, you are going to see white people. If you look at an African summit, you are going to see mostly black people. If you look at an American summit, you are going to be mostly white people. Why so? There were people before the Europeans arrived in America. But the thing, it has to do with germs and diseases. When Europeans arrived in Africa, they were killed by tropical diseases. When Europeans arrived in America, they killed with smallpox. With different immunity processes and different diseases led Europeans to populate the Americas while they couldn't populate Africa. And so a very important part of the Americas population is of European stock. There are some aboriginal components as well, mostly in four countries, which are deep green: Bolivia, Peru, Ecuador, and Guatemala. These are the only countries in which you have a two-digit figure of aboriginal people. Maybe Mexico, depending on how you count it. As for the rest, in Brazil, it's fewer than 1%. Then you have black population, those who were brought from Africa and their descendants. So it's, we could say, a melting pot if it was successful. Many times it's not successful. So you have whites on top and the rest at the bottom. But in any case, this makes of Latin America a different region from Africa and Europe alike. And now I will show you a series of maps that try to argument that integration is not natural to Latin America. But again, it's not a failure. Latin America is not an exception. The exception is Europe. To share sovereignty with the neighbors, it's an exception in the world. The world is Westphalian. Countries are very jealous of their sovereignty. They don't want to share it. They want to have their own currency. They want to have their own borders and control over their borders. So Latin America is just a case of normal countries. European countries are abnormal. The other map was the Americas, as they call it in English, the 35 countries. This is Latin America, 20 independent states. There are 35 countries in the whole Western Hemisphere. Two are developed, the US and Canada. 20 speak either Spanish, Portuguese, or French, Haiti. And then there are 13 Caribbean or Central American countries, which are former European colonies as well, mostly British, but not only. And many times, for statistical or institutional reasons, we speak of Latin America and the Caribbean, so 33 countries. But Latin America has an identity that is not the same as the Caribbean. To start with, in the Caribbean, they mostly speak English or Dutch. So that makes a difference. Then the Spaniards, they wanted to go back to the continent they had been expelled from 2 centuries ago, and they created this Ibero-American concept. And they invited the Portuguese, who very gladly agreed, because the Spanish are paying and the Portuguese are taking benefit. This is a story of the relation between Portugal and Spain. Spain does the job and Portugal is more intelligent. Just kidding, if there are Spanish people. No, Portuguese people know they are more intelligent. The thing is that if you go to the official documents of the Spanish government, you are going to find Latin America called Ibero-America, because they think of a joint community that Spain itself integrates. If you go to the official documents of most Spanish-speaking Latin American states, you are going to find Latin America. If you go to Brazil, you are going to find South America, because the Brazilians tried to cut off a part of the continent that took Mexico and the US out. So Brazil, 2 decades ago, decided that they could not compete for influence with the US, and that Mexico was already under the influence of the US. So they are, they wouldn't say this backyard, their region, their zone of influence, was South America. So in Brazil, they speak of their region as South America. In the Spanish-speaking countries, as Latin America. In Spain, as Ibero-America. They are not exactly the same, they overlap. And then about things that matter, regional organizations that make binding decisions on their members. You have this that was originally founded in 1960, the Montevideo Treaty, and they were thinking after the European processes of integration. Europe started the integration process in the 50s, and so the Latin Americans said, this is going to be bad for us, because Europe is going to close into itself. And so we need to scale up our markets in order to compensate for the loss of the European market. So they started integrating as well, but this never went farther than free trade. This is not a customs union, this is not a common market, this is not an economic union, the four stages of integration. But when I showed you the previous map, Central America was excluded. So when they speak of Latin America, they think of South America plus Mexico and maybe Cuba. And so Central America started a different process of integration at the same time, 1960, funded by the United States. Because the US wanted to buy scale and stability as well, as much as to organize America Central. That's right. And this is a new creation. This is an old map, because Paraguay was suspended in order to take Venezuela in. Venezuela is now suspended because it doesn't comply with the democratic laws, and it has also not internalized, not transposed the Mercosur legislation into domestic legislation. Venezuela is cast away of almost everything that works in Latin America. Not many things work in Latin America. But Mercosur is a regional bloc that the European Union recognizes, acknowledges as one of itself. The European Union would like to clone itself into other regions because it feels that, we say in political science, an N equal to one, the only one of its kind. The EU would like to see the world organized in regional groupings, but it doesn't see the world in such way. It's trying to create that world. So they are promoting integration in other regions. They are giving money, they are giving ideas, they are giving models, but it's not enough, if you ask me. Not enough money, we want more. Yeah, this is kidding, but if you talk to diplomats in Latin America, in small countries, they would say cooperation is good, this money is welcome, it is helpful. If you talk to the larger countries, they would say that's peanuts. What we really want is trade. Open up your markets and we will make our own money with our competitive production. If you don't open your market, you are not going to compensate us with coins. This is the Andean community. Also, Venezuela was a member, it left. Chile was a member, it left. So it moves also in Latin America, but it's not really meaningful. The Andean community, in fact, doesn't work as a customs union, which it is on paper, because its countries have signed trade agreements separately with the US and the European Union. This is UNASUR. UNASUR, Comunidad Andina, yeah, that's it. And this is UNASUR. Many countries left UNASUR, some countries are getting back to UNASUR. It was a Brazilian creation that was briefly hijacked by Hugo Chavez. And the idea is, again, this is not about integration, this is about cooperation and political dialogue. They were reducing conflicts by administering them. They were not sharing sovereignty. Every time there is a new organization created in Latin America, one of the first things they say is, this is to reinforce national sovereignty, so we are going for regional integration. This is a contradiction in terms. Where either you have integration or you have national sovereignty. They may be both good, but you can't have both of them at the same time. The more integration you have, the less national sovereignty you have. Portugal cannot issue money, but it decided not to issue money alone. It issues money together with 19 other countries. That's okay. But this is not national sovereignty, it's regional integration. But Portugal has an army. That's national sovereignty, even if it coordinates with NATO members. And this is ALBA. ALBA was an alternative to the Americas project of the United States. The most interesting thing about ALBA, which is Venezuelan-led, is that it is the only regional organization in the world in which no member has borders with any other member. It's an archipelago. It's the clients of Venezuela. Venezuela gives oil and receives support, votes in international organizations. And again, it's not about sharing sovereignty. And the most recent, not the most recent because that's Prosur, but Prosur was never supposed to work. And this was Pacific Alliance. It's Mexico, Colombia, Peru, and Chile. And they say that they're very successful. They are very successful at selling themselves. But this is not a process of real integration. Why? Because they don't trade with each other. Total trade within this region is 1%. This is a region created to put a flag on themselves to say we are open to trade, we negotiate with everybody, and we respect our agreements. It's about marketing, it's about branding, and that's okay. But it's most people here, most countries require visa for some other countries of the same organization. It's nothing to do with the European process of integration. There are lots of restrictions, lots of obstacles in the border. So when we speak of integration in Latin America, we do not refer to the same process as in Europe. In Europe, countries share sovereignty. In Latin America, they don't. They just cooperate. And we are about to finish. This is the integration the United States think of together with Canada and Mexico. These are agreements that have expiry date, just like the European Coalition Community. So it changed its name. In the last years, it was NAFTA in the beginning, now it's USMCA. It's very difficult to pronounce, but it's just about free trade and some regulations regarding environment and labor. It doesn't mean that if you're Mexican, you can travel freely to the US. And this is the community of Latin American and Caribbean states that came to Brussels last week and had a meeting with the European Union. What is behind this? This is a forum. This is not an organization. It has not legal personality, no budget, no personnel, no headquarters. It is a forum in which all these countries get together and meet with European Union representatives or China. So it's diplomacy of scale. The United States doesn't need this because they have the Organization of American States. This is why the US hates this, because this is helpful for Latin American countries to get to Brussels or Beijing, and for China and the EU to travel once and get together with 33 countries. This is not good for the US. But in any case, this is not about integration. And this is how integration looks in the Americas. There is no concentricity. There are very sub-regional organizations. Some of them are effective at their task. Their task is always much less ambitious than in Europe. And there is nothing like a common axis. The Franco-German axis built Europe. The equivalent would be Mexico and Brazil. It is not equivalent. It is not expected to be equivalent. They are 1,000 kilometers, 10,000 kilometers apart, 5,000 in their closer borders. And they don't share common interests. If you look at the G20, there are 20 countries, 19 plus the European Union, three Latin American countries, Brazil, Mexico, and Argentina. They never coordinate their positions in the G20. They don't have common interests. They like each other. We like each other in Latin America. Nobody likes Argentina, but for the rest, just kidding, they like us too much. But we don't do things together because we don't have the common interest. We are not necessarily competitive. It's not that whatever is better for Brazil is worse for Argentina. The world is big enough for all of us. China is going to buy our soy for Argentina, Brazil, Paraguay, whoever sells. China is big enough for everybody. So we don't fight with each other, but we don't share sovereignty with each other because we don't need to. And just last trends, in order for us to understand that the pandemic hit differently in Latin America and in Europe. Europe came out of the pandemic just as before. No real consequences. You look at the European country today and you looked at it 4 years ago and it's kind of the same. While in Latin America, poverty started to rise again. It was rising already after a couple of decades of reduction of poverty. Informality. This is not about Latin America. This is developed countries at the bottom, blue line, developing countries on top, red line. Informality is what makes the difference between development and developing countries. And informality is not just that people are not protected socially. It's also that states are unable to count their population and to tax their population and to protect their population. And Latin America has a very informal economy. As much as 70% of informality in Peru, 50 in Argentina, 30, yeah, it's getting to 50. It's much better than Peru, but still not good. In Uruguay and Chile, they are much more institutionalized and formalized economies, but still not as much as in Europe. And this, because otherwise, I told you there are wars everywhere, but not in Latin America. We have different ways of killing each other. Crime. The most violent countries in time of peace are all located in the Americas. From Jamaica, the Northern Triangle, but Honduras, Guatemala, and El Salvador. And then Brazil, Mexico, Colombia. Here, the more colorful you are, the worse it is. To give you just a figure, in Latin America, live 8% of the world population. Every 100 people, 8 are Latin Americans. But there is 35% of the world homicides. In Brazil, there is less than 3% of the world population and 15% of the world homicides. But these homicides are especially cruel with the popular sector, with the poor, with the young, with the youth, with the male, with the people who live in slums. So most of us who are tourists in these countries don't suffer from violence. We don't see it. We see the figures. We don't suffer it daily. If you go to Buenos Aires, even to Rio de Janeiro, it's quite safe for us who are white and rich. For people who are not, this is more difficult. So these are the problems of Latin America. Not wars, not nuclear radiation, not nuclear attacks, but poverty, inequality, which is related, informality, and violence derived from crime. Last one, I hope. The problem is not yet democracy. Latin America is one of the most democratic regions in the world. Not the most, that would be Western Europe or North America, but it's much more. Here, red is bad, blue is good. The bluer, the more democratic. The redder, the less democratic. So as you can see, they are living under autocratic or authoritarian regimes in massive numbers in Asia and Africa, while in Latin America, the non-democracies are the exception. There are important exceptions. Cuba, of course, whose legitimacy is a revolution, not democracy, and then Venezuela, who was a democracy until it wasn't. And then there are very small countries, like Nicaragua, and some others who are backsliding. But yet, if you have to define Latin America, 40 years ago, it was a non-democratic continent. Today, it is mostly a democratic continent, only with informality in the economic sector, in the economy, with poverty and with violence, but with no wars. So you can see Latin America and Europe are more and more peripheral, but they are suffering from very different problems. Can they cooperate to solve them? It's very difficult to say. Their paths are diverging, not converging. I stop here, so we discuss. Thank you very much.
As we announced, actually, we got so much, actually, so we need some time to kind of, you know. No, I'm not speaking about the length of the presentation, but the intensity of the data we have to swallow, you know. Hopefully, we will, we didn't ask you, but we hope that we will get permission to get it at the internet recording progressing as it was yesterday. And so we will be glad to have it for the people who were not with us and for those who would like to remind themselves about so many data. And thank you very much for bringing all those things, you know. So I'm more than sure that you will have a lot of things to ask. Mike, please, just instruction, please press it and keep it all the way as you are speaking, actually. So since Portugal has been mentioned so many times here, I will have to start with Mr. João, please.
But
press it.
That's a tricky question. Thank you for that. Until some years ago, the Global South used to include China, which was totally ridiculous. Right now, China is a global power. It's no longer part of a residual part of the continent or of the world, which is not the developed countries. So the Global South today is kind of an heir of the non-alignment movements. It's the countries that are not in the north, not rich, not developed, but neither are they China. The thing is, what do they have in common? And what they have in common is that they are not developed. But as I argued, their paths are diverging. They are not developed by different reasons, and they are going through paths which are leading them to different places. So it's useful to think of yourself as an underdog, in order to know who is strong enough to harm you. But underdogs don't always have the same interest, common interests or capacity of coordination. So what is the Common South? What countries that are not powerful say is the Global South? What is the usefulness of this label? They are yet to find out.
Is it working?
Yeah.
Stefan Gajic, Institute of European Studies. Thank you so much for this very interesting and inspiring lecture. And there were so many aspects, but I will only focus on one. At the beginning, you have showed the map of how the world is divided. So on one map, there were countries that condemned Russia, but on the other, the countries that imposed sanctions. And there is a stark difference between the two. And also, what was, let's say, the idea that was floating around was decolonization, colonization, colonies, as such, and so on. So, in my opinion, and I think in the opinion of many people in Serbia, is that the colonization really never ended. And that's why we have the difference between the two maps. For instance, Serbia has three times officially condemned Russia in the United Nations, whereas the vast majority of Serbs support Russia because, of course, of our bitter experience with NATO in 95 and 99. So, and many people think also that we are a crypto colony of the West. And another thing was that you mentioned China as an emerging global power. However, China is not posing any kind of an ideological alternative. It comes with investments. Its banks want to make money. They have all of these workers that have to be employed outside of China because of the nature of its economy. So Russia basically is the only country that is challenging the global liberal order. Although it itself doesn't know what it really wants. It knows more what it does not want. So it's not offering a holistic ideological product like the communism was in the past. It is also in some kind of a struggle within ideas. But what my answer is, how is it perceived? And this is, of course, impossible to answer, because it probably depends from country to country. But how, in general, is this conflict perceived in Latin America? Is it perceived as a chance once in a million years for the end of the U.S. hegemony, or is it only perceived as a distant conflict in Europe that has nothing to do with us? Thank you so much.
Thank you for your question. It is right that China influences world politics differently from the U.S., from the West. The West imposes political conditionality, human rights, democracy, free press. China doesn't, but it imposes economic conditionality. I want my loan back. I want my investment protected. That is all right. But it's not that conditionalities are absent, only they are different. And many countries accept this because they need money, and China provides it. As to Russia, well, it is not exactly offering an alternative to the global liberal order, which I would call the Western order, which is not global or liberal. And neither is it rule-based. The global order was a mask for Western domination. And I say this without deprecating Western domination. It was better than the alternatives in the time. But right now, the world is splitting. We still don't know what is going to happen. There are two ways of looking at what is happening. The first one is a hegemonic transition. There is a hegemon, the US, which is declining. There is a challenger, China, which is ascending. And then we can have this transition through war or not. This is the two-sided trap. But there is another way of looking at this. Not a transition, but entropy. We are not going from one order to the other, but from one order to disorder. And so far, Russia is a producer of disorder for many in the world, which may not be bad, because sometimes you have to break things before you rebuild things. But Russia is not in the condition of offering a different worldview of world order. Neither is China so far, but many people are betting on China to be a future producer of world order, or at least half a world order. So Russia is seen by many as a spoiler. There are exceptions. Russia is important in Venezuela. It used to be important in Cuba, now China is fighting for it, Nicaragua, and especially many African countries in which the elites were trained in Russia, and they speak Russian, and they trade with Russia. But this is a very particular way of being connected to Russia. It's not Russia offering an alternative worldview. It's Russia offering particularistic goods, which is fine. But when the... No, yes. Well, no. Well, but... as you know, this is an outcast. But the thing is that we don't know whether China can provide this alternative worldview. Russia so far hasn't offered it.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Now it's working. Perfect. So first of all, Professor, I would like to thank you for yet another amazing lecture. And I just had a few questions. So first of all, do you think the West is aware of its increasingly peripheral status? Second of all, how do you predict the result of the war in Ukraine, if you have any predictions? I mean, I know it's a very tough question, obviously. And do you think there's any way that we could come to a sort of diplomatic solution to the conflict anytime soon? I would also like to know what explains the geopolitical stability in Latin America. I mean, I've read Recupero's work on Latin America and sort of the diplomacy, the skillful Brazilian diplomacy, and when borders were being negotiated with Argentina and so on. So what are some other factors? And lastly, is Brazil still considered as global south, or could we see Brazil as a global player? Thank you.
I remember all these very good questions. The first one, I already forgot.
Yes.
Yeah, that's good. Mostly not.
Yeah.
If you look at Europe, they still think they are relevant. And they don't understand why the world is not lining up with them. For them, it's very difficult to understand what is happening in the world because they don't understand the world anymore. In the US, they have a different vision, but they never understood really the world. The thing is that they are powerful enough as to mold, as to shape the world. So they don't care. They don't care. They are powerful enough as to ignore how the world works because it works as they want it to work. Part of it. For Europe, well, when you see of Macron speaking of strategic autonomy, you know how lost they are. Because the other 26 countries in the European Union say, okay, we don't really like to be the luckiest of the United States, but the least we want is to be your lucky, France. But the thing is that France is trying to lead an alternative building of a world order to the US, and the rest of the European countries are either very US-inclined, especially the Baltic countries, the Eastern countries in Europe, those who are closer to Russia, or those on the Atlantic, like Portugal and the UK. But in any case, they don't like France to be the alternative to the US, and they are afraid of Russia and of China. So they are afraid of the world that is becoming. The second question was about the war. I can see two scenarios in which the war, ends. In the first one, Putin is deposed, like the Kaiser in the First World War. And so the next government has no choice but to make peace because it's too weak to sustain war. The other one is Trump wins the election in the United States, and so Putin wins the war. So whether Putin is deposed and Russia loses, or Trump wins and Russia wins, that's two possibilities. Otherwise, it's going to be prolonged conflict. There is no end in sight, no diplomatic solution.
I wanted to say that I studied at the Quartier campus that deals with Latin America, the experience in Instagram, that it would be really great to have you on the
show. With Olivier Daben? Great place to study.
I'm glad that we have more than 10 persons with us also at Zoom, including our guest from last year, Mr. Juan Radonjic, who is also friend with our guest today. And I would like to greet him very much and to say that we are so happy and honored to have him also with us. And so we continue, actually, very Professor Zečević was asking.
No. Okay, thank you for your exposure, and I agree with you about Macron's, but it's not Macron's vision, it's General de Gaulle's vision of European strategic autonomy. But I want to thank you also because you said a lot about Latin American organization, integration, and the difference in between Europe and Latin American. And I think we are not aware here in Serbia about the big difference between European integration and all others integration in the world. And I think in the beginning the European integration was a federal idea to create federal states, united European states, and that is so deep, so strong, and you are really show how it's not so deep and not so strong in the Latin America and America also, North America also. And thank you for that. I think these young people must know that. I mean, you have in the European integration so many aspects, economic, free moving of people and everything. And in Latin America, you don't have that. And I think the cause is a federal idea of European integration. And thank you very much for that.
So one question from Greg Simmons. What do you think will be the short and long-term effect of the woke ideology and the enforcement mechanism of cancel culture on European integration, especially given the current liberal-conservative divide between old and new member states of the EU?
Well, that's a good question, whether domestic politics can get in the way of European integration. So far, Europe underwent four key crises in the last decade: Brexit, immigration, the Euro crisis, and the emergence of populism. We still don't know what may happen. There was a challenge that was serious when Hungary and Poland were together blocking a sanction against each other by the European Commission. But right now they are split by the war. Poland clearly lined up with the West and most of Europe, and Hungary as the outcast that thinks differently to the rest. It's difficult to tell, but we can't see so far a domino effect, either from cancel culture, the woke ideology, or from populism, right-wing populism. What we can see is that most of the crisis had been controlled, administered, and isolated. So no domino effect. If you look at the country in which right-wing, not necessarily populism, took power, which is Italy, Giorgia Meloni is very much for European integration. She's very much Atlanticist, and she's not pro-Putin, which Berlusconi was. And some of his coalition, her coalition partners are as well. She's not. So it's much less.
I also, of course, want to thank Professor Greg Simons, who was also recently cancelled. He was professor at Uppsala University for a very long time. Actually, I had the chance to meet him and so on. But many professors, that's about how the things are being affected in that people who didn't want to join to the general canceling culture, they have been canceled. And if I could just add, that's really, in a way, you could see that the war and everything that's going on has been, in a way, you know, like covering previous internal ideological and value debates that were really starting to affect, like Istanbul Convention and so on. But of course, as long as the war is going on and Americans are, you know, controlling stuff more or less, the things will be postponed, but nobody knows what's going to happen in the future. My question was something else, actually. By the way, I will have to mention also and to greet our other colleague, Maria Helena Carreiras, who happens to be our colleague working at the Institute of Sociology, also who is PhD in sociologist, and a wife of our guest today, and who is Minister of Defense in Portugal, first woman actually who is at this position. So my whole question wanted to go a little bit into the security stuff. You were mentioning about economic institutional stuff. We partly touched upon ideology. That is also, I yesterday posed the question about what's going on in ideology, but it's definitely not so important like security stuff and so on. So, but we didn't speak about security alternative. In a way, you mentioned that USA is still providing kind of security for EU, basically. What's going on with Latin America in that sense? How is it changing? How is this new, let me say, transition, if we can speak about transition, at least in economical stuff, we could definitely speak. But did it affect, let me say, security orientation of Latin American states? Are Russian or maybe Chinese more present with not only with their, I'm not speaking about the bases, but arms or technology, which is definitely, because I have to share my first impression in Argentina, how the world is globalizing, that in Argentina you got you see a lot of Chinese investments and Turkish TV series, actually, that are starting to dominate over Latin American continent. It used to be the main provider of, you know, global telenovelas domination and so on. So my question is really, what's going on with security and some issue, if this is official, which is affecting us? As you know, Serbia is officially neutral from 2007, although we didn't develop this concept. And coming from that perspective, we are not so happy that, you know, two more neutral countries raised their neutrality recently, as we know, Finland and Sweden. I mean, it's the process, but it is going on. So definitely there is Australia, Switzerland, Austria. By the way, they have I'm joking a little bit, in Vienna at the airport, they have the shirts with, you know, kangaroo and saying, we are not Australia. So I didn't got the lesson, definitely, you know. So Austria, Switzerland, and Serbia are trying to stay neutral. And Bosnia, sorry, it's to respect for the, because of Republic of Srpska insistence and so on. So what's with that concept, for example, in Latin America and generally about security issues there? Thank you very much.
I will try to answer with data, with evidence, not with my opinion. In June last year, there was a summit of NATO. And this was a summit to define the new strategic concept. Who is the enemy? Who is the challenger? And what are the resources they put together in order to defend themselves from the rival, the enemy and the challenger? The enemy is Russia, the challenger is China. And there were some 45 countries participating at this meeting, this NATO summit. There are 30 members, plus Sweden and Finland, who were about to be included, plus almost all the European neutral countries, Austria, Ireland, were invited as well, plus the Indo-Pacific, not the Indo-Pacific, the Eastern Pacific nations, Japan, South Korea, Australia, New Zealand, Jacinda Ardern was a figure participating, plus Jordan in representation of the Middle East, plus Mauritania in representation of the Sahel, south of Sahara in Africa. There was only one region missing with no representative at the summit. Latin America was the only region missing, and it was the only region in which never a nuclear bomb was developed. There are no countries possessing the nuclear bomb today in Africa, but there was one, South Africa, that dismantled it in the past. Well, Oceania, if we take it as a continent, doesn't have a nuclear bomb, but there are nuclear bombs everywhere else. A nuclear submarine. Well, in the case of Australia. In the case of Africa, there are nuclear reactors, but these are also in Latin America, Mexico, Brazil, and Argentina. But this is for peaceful ends. And Argentina and Brazil have the only supranational system in the world of monitoring mutual installments, facilities of nuclear energy. So there are technicians from Brazil going to Argentina, from Argentina going to Brazil, and revising each other nuclear material. So confidence-building measures. So Latin America is a region that knows that it has no nuclear weapons and no nuclear threats. And it does not intend to develop whether weapons or threats. In the case of Argentina right now, Argentina has no working submarines. It used to have in the past. Argentina used to have an aircraft carrier during the Malvinas War. It didn't use the aircraft carrier, but it had it. And Argentina has no supersonic jets. At this moment, Argentina is kind of disarmed, if you ask a military specialist. While Chile is not, Brazil is not, Colombia is not, and Venezuela has the Sukhoi, the Russian players. So it's not that Latin America is disarmed, but it's much more lightly armed than the rest of the world. And there are no really, really real hypotheses of conflicts. Most Latin American countries don't contemplate the possibility of waging war with their neighbors or non-neighbors. Argentina went to war with Britain in 82. Now this possibility is excluded absolutely from the minds of both Argentines and Brits. So what shall they defend from? China is not intervening in Latin America in military terms. It's not intruding in Africa in military terms. China is just trying to defend the South China Sea with their own military. As for the rest, it's economic statecraft. It's not military statecraft. Russia is trying to incommodate the US in its backyard. So it has military business going on with Venezuela, mostly with Venezuela, some things with Nicaragua and Cuba. And they send naval ships from time to time, and they sell weapons, and they spoil. They are spoiler, Latin America. They are not a contender. They are not a challenger, and they are not even a threat. But they are spoiler. China is not. And this is very relevant. And the reason why no Latin American representative was present in Madrid at this NATO summit is because NATO partners don't contemplate the need to involve Latin America into their security needs. So Latin America is kind of cast away, an outcast in global security terms, and this is good. We are as peripheral as we can get, and we are fine with that.
Can we stay neutral? What do you think?
Well, mostly so. They are not neutral. They vote against the invasion. They condemned the invasion of Ukraine.
I was asking about us here in Serbia. Yeah.
I will not answer that.
No, I
think you will for different reasons. And again, it's not bad to be neutral.
Thank you very much. Should I say obrigado or gracias? Speaking
about the split identity. Since we are finishing official part, it was really more than honor having you, and we enjoyed very much. And always, what I insist is really, I'm so happy that there are so many of young colleagues that we have here, and our Hispanist colleagues that are together with us today, who are really getting a chance to see European and Latin American science combine in its best way. It was really great time, and we really learned quite a lot. Thanks a lot to Jelena also, and Bojana, Dan, and all people really, who people from Asociacion de Hispanistas de Serbia. With this, we are finishing our working season. Finally, we are going to vacation as well. Ferragosto is starting also for us. And starting from September 1st, we will continue our regular work, I hope, with some other good guests and so on. Thank you all very much. All the best to people who followed us in Europe, in Latin America as well, and so on. And thank you. Please press and just announce the rest of the programs, the future programs that will be in the next couple of days.
Yeah, okay. Thank you very much to the Institute, to you who came to hear our guest. We are very happy to have him here with us. And I'm sure this is only the beginning of some very perspective cooperation. As far as our summer school regarding, we will continue today at 6 o'clock with Professor Gorica Majstorović from the United States. She will speak us about some interesting topic regarding literature. Tomorrow we are continuing with Andrea Jeftanović, who will speak us about using archives in the literature and mixing that documentary part with the literature, and then give us workshop of creative writing. And on Sunday, Bojana Kovačević Petrović from the University of Novi Sad will speak about some literary topic and give a workshop about creating and writing essays. So in few months we hope that we will have las actas, works and contributions from our participants. We have 30 participants this year, more or less, and they are coming from different countries, from Serbia, Romania, Czech Republic, Mexico, then Paris. Let's say this is our student, but she's finishing her study there. From Spain also, so we are very pleased to have all them with us. Thank you again.